they teach you how to not forget your keys, which is a problem that crops up both when trying to get into the house sometimes, and when building complex web apps, crossover you didn't think you'd see today. So I'm specifically talking about keyboard accessibility rather than accessibility as a whole for a couple of reasons. One, it's something that affects a broad range of users, and it's pretty much a prerequisite for a lot of assistive tech, like screen readers. You need to start with keyboard accessibility. And also because it's within kind of our control as developers, whereas often stuff like color contrasts and font choices are often the province of designers and can lead to fights, whereas keyboard accessibility is something you can do right now without, you know, outside input. So, people who need keyboard accessibility. There are humans as well as cats who have trouble with mice. And those people, So, those people aren't only, people think of like, people who are blind often when you think about accessibility, and people who use screen readers do need keyboard accessibility because you navigate with a screen reader through the keyboard. And there's often a lot of other options to navigate when you're using a screen reader, like jumping through headings and jumping through form inputs, tabbing, stuff like that. So that's one way of navigating the keyboard. Another way is if you are low vision, so you might be using a screen reader, you might not, and you're also using a screen. So you can't assume if somebody's navigating with a keyboard that they're hearing your website. They could also be looking at it, or they could be doing both. So you want to match those up. You can't have like screen reader only content that's confusing if you're looking at a screen. Another one is people who have perfect vision and can see fine and have some sort of mobility impairment, so you know, Parkinson's, ALS, something that makes it difficult to use a mouse. So you could use a keyboard or often some sort of device that uses keyboard-like events that's much easier to navigate with and much easier to control. And also it could be you. You could at some point, you know, go to the hospital and have an accident and not be able to see for a couple of weeks because you need eye surgery, or you could sprain your wrist and be in a cast and not be able to use a mouse very well. So it could happen. And you'll notice there's also a wide range of familiarity with the tech. So somebody who went blind when they were a child and has been using a screen reader for the past 10 years is going to know all the shortcuts and probably be able to navigate through even a poorly accessible site. But somebody who, you know, sprained their wrists 2 weeks ago may only know how to like tab through the site. They don't know how to do anything else. So you need to make sure that sites are accessible through kind of a wide range of methods and knowledge. So this is my favorite app to hate on, to do MVC. You've probably seen it. It's the app you look at when you're comparing Angular 2 versus React. And it is one of the worst examples of accessibility I've ever seen. So you can see, I wrote a little script so you can see what key I'm hitting. I'm just trying to tab through, and you can see as soon as I leave the initial input, it doesn't even have a focus outline, you can only see the cursor. You can't see where you are at all until you hit the bottom links. And I actually added that focus outline back in just so you can see something. So what it is you're tabbing through each checkbox. If you're on a screen reader, it doesn't help either because the labels aren't associated with the checkboxes, so you don't hear anything. You only hear checkbox unchecked, checkbox unchecked, checkbox unchecked. And also, there should be a way to edit these to-dos, and that's by double-clicking. It's in JavaScript, it's a double-click event. There's no way to do that with a keyboard. And there's a delete button that you access on hover, but only on hover. And obviously you can't get to that with a keyboard, so this is impossible to use with a keyboard entirely. You can create new to-dos if you want, you can sort of check them if you guess where you are, but you can't edit them, you can't delete them, you have no idea where you are. Also, the color contrast is awful. I love to hate on it, it's awful. So using this is kind of like encountering a rip in space-time, web space. And this is a screenshot from developer tools. They put outline none on button and input type equals checkbox. And I think this is a perfect example of how the web is inherently accessible and we make it inaccessible by things we do. So never do that. It's removing the only visual focus indicator and it's not providing anything in its place. And the other thing they did, the delete button, they put on display none. And both screen readers and the keyboard pay attention to CSS. If you do display none or visibility hidden, that removes an element from the focus order and it removes it from the screen reader tree as well. So the destroy button, the delete button is gone, and the focus string is gone. So they could have done this better by targeting focus styles specifically if they decided that the default blue focus ring or dotted focus ring in Firefox was too ugly. They could have gotten rid of the outline and done something like the box shadow, different border color, different background color. You have tons of options so long as it's obvious and, you know, easily viewable. And the other thing for their delete button is they could have done opacity zero, which does not remove something from the focus order. And then when you can target it with focus and put the opacity back in. So that means you can focus to it as well as hover. This also would have been much easier to do for hover. They could have done the focus selector and the hover selector instead of putting in a JavaScript hover event. I don't know why they did that. Maybe to show off app hover events, but yeah, much easier, stays in focus order. You can see it when you tap to it. Pretty easy, it's not that hard. So, more practical examples. That should have been fixed by better passive focus management. I'm also gonna talk about active focus management. So passive is, you know, you set up your DOM well, you set up your tab indices or native elements well, and you can access things kind of by default. But there are times when you actually need active focus management. And some of those things are when you're opening menus or dialogues, you might need to send focus into something actively because you're creating some content that pops up on the screen, and it's not like in sequential log order. So an example, this is the Washington Post. This is still a bad example. Sorry, the Washington Post. If you can't tell what I'm doing, I'm tabbing through, and I open the menu programmatically just because I want you to be able to see where the focus is. But what's happening is as you tab through the Washington Post website, you start tabbing into the hidden menu. The menu is visually hidden, it's still in the focus order, it's obviously right after the header and the DOM, so you tab directly into it after you leave the header. And if you're on a screen and you're not using a screen reader, you have absolutely no idea where you are because you can't see anything, keep hitting tab, nothing happens. And it's because you're in this giant hidden menu, you're gonna have to hit tab like 30 times before you get out of it. And obviously a bad user experience. You don't know where you are, you can't do anything. If you try hitting enter, suddenly you end up on a new page and you don't know what happened. So what they should have done is they should have hidden the menu. They could have done display none. That does have performance impacts for animation like this. So alternatively, they could have gone through and made everything, took everything out of the focus order with tab index. But yeah, if you don't do that, that's what you end up with. ABC News has the opposite problem. You open the menu and then you don't tab into it, you tab behind it. So what I'm doing is I'm getting to the menu button, I hit enter, the menu opens, I keep tabbing, and I end up behind the menu. So same issue, the menu's there, that's all you see on the screen if you're using a screen, and you hit tab and you're never in it. So what they should have done is, as soon as you open the menu, they should have called focus on the first focusable element. So that's the active focus management. They should have sent it into the menu as soon as it opened and kept you in the menu for as long as it was covering the rest of the page. So takeaways, if you're building something like this, if it's visible, then it should be focusable. And I mean for interactive elements, obviously not your headings and text. But if it's visible, you should be able to focus on it at some point. If it's not visible, in contrast, for those of you who like formal logic, if and only if it's visible. If it's not visible, it should not be focusable. You should never get to it with a keyboard if you can't get to it with a mouse. Same deal, like if you can interact with something with a mouse, you should be able to interact with it with a keyboard, so that like hover or delete button, bad idea, because you can only do it with a mouse. I feel like that should kind of go without saying with touch devices now, but still hover only events are a thing. And your options to do this are pretty much CSS with display none or visibility hidden, or JavaScript by manipulating tab index and a few other options that I'll go over. And there are occasionally exceptions, but you want to make sure you really know what you're doing and to make sure you're doing it in the interest of people who use keyboards. So, keyboard patterns. I talked about how to put things in the focus order and how to manage the focus order, but there's more than just focus order, and if you only ever rely on tabbing and focus, you're going to end up with people hitting tab, you know, 2 million times to get through your beautiful but giant menu widget with 50 links. Okay, only 50 tabs, but you know. Still a lot of tabs, you get bored, you're hitting tab, it's a lot of work to just get past a single widget. So the wide area authoring practices, if you're interested, it's the Web Accessibility Initiative, accessible rich internet applications, and it's much less dry than it sounds. It's actually a fantastic document with a bunch of widget patterns, and they go into detail about what keyboard patterns you need and access patterns and stuff like that. But their opinion on this is if you're building a web component, like a web component unit, you should have one tab that takes you into it, and the second tab should take you out. So essentially, a single component, single stop in the focus order. And the way you do this is instead of making everything directly in the focus order, and that means tab index equals zero, not -1. There's a difference between focus order and focusable. Focusable means you can send focus to it, and focus order means that if you keep it in tab, you'll get to it, essentially. So you keep things focusable, but you directly manage focus, and you do it by listening to other key events, like arrows, page up, page down, enter space. You want to actually include those in your more complex components and widgets. So this is directly from their examples. It's a menu widget, and you'll notice you tab in once, and as soon as you're in there, you start using arrow keys to navigate instead of just tab. There is a second opinion about this, which says that everything in the top level should be in the focus order, so you can tab through top level menu links and then use arrow keys to go down. That's okay too for a menu. For something like a select or I don't know, tabs, then I think really it should just be one tab stop. But for a menu, because it's links, I'd say it's acceptable to have top level items in the focus order and use arrows to get down into it. But essentially the idea is you think about more keys than just tabs, and you try to keep your single a single component from taking up a whole bunch of tabs to get through. So focus traps, other great widget keyboard pattern. And like cats in cardboard boxes, you want to use this with care. It's dangerous, trap too many cats in a cardboard box. And you can get weird situations. I foster cats, I know. So use with care. And for focus traps, there's essentially two situations I've come across where you might want to use them. One is a modal. So any sort of modal that covers up page content that has an overlay, or even just that makes page content inaccessible, or a slide-out menu, kind of like in the mobile sites I showed before. And that also, like a slide-out menu that's meant to obscure content or that you're meant to deal with before you're allowed to go back to page content. So the idea is if you're obscuring page content for mouse users, or if you're, if you're obscuring page content for mouse users, then you want to do that for keyboard users too. But because you can't just hide it, you have to trap them inside whatever it is they're supposed to be paying attention to. So what you do, there's two basic approaches to this. There's the active approach and the passive approach. So the active approach is the easier approach in this case. You listen to the focus event, or actually the focus in event, because the focus in event, you probably know this, but it bubbles. Whereas the focus event only fires on the actual element that's focused. So focus in on document level, you look for the document active element. If it's not within your trap, then you send the person back into the trap. By directly calling focus on probably the first focusable element in your focus trap. So it's active approach, you listen to where they are, listen to what the focus element is, or the active element is, and you always send it back into the trap when they try to leave. The drawback to this is that you actually never get to the Chrome of the browser. Normally, if you're tabbing through a web page, when you hit the last focusable element and you hit tab, you go back to the browser Chrome, like the URL bar and back in next and stuff. If you do this, you never will. So that's the drawback, and that's one that diverges from mouse users, because if you're using a mouse, obviously you can always close a tab or click on the URL bar, and suddenly you're taking that away from keyboard users. But I'm not going to say don't do it, because it's still the easiest way to create a focus trap, and it's still widely used. So it's not bad, it's just a little worse than the second option, which is to passively manage focus by going through and changing tab index. But the annoying thing is that, tab index, it's not inherited. So every focusable item needs that. You need to actively change tab index on it. And that means you probably also need to save the previous tab index in case it wasn't zero, it could have been -1 already, so you need to save it, you need to go through, change it back when it's not, when the modal isn't open anymore. So it's a little annoying. There is a solution to this, and that's the inert attribute. It's in proposed spec. It's not in spec yet. It's not supported yet. But there's a Google Chrome polyfill, or a polyfill put out by the Google Chrome team. So if you want to use that today, you could, along with the polyfill. It uses, I think, DOM mutation observers, so it's not super performant. Obviously, the most performant is the focus listener. But it's an option, and it's quite nice because then it simulates, it better simulates mouse usage. So, if you do decide to go through and change all your focusables, this is essentially how you do it. That's a wonderful monster selector for every focusable element. And you need to do this or something like it if you don't use an NERT and you want to change your focusables. So other practical things, changing tab index or listening to a focus event, that only affects people who are using the keyboard directly and not using the screen reader. As I mentioned, screen readers have other ways to navigate content, so they will still be aware of hidden content or unfocusable content, and if you're using a screen reader, you could still navigate to it, unless you also put aria hidden equals true or hidden on an element that supports it. So you want to handle hiding stuff from screen readers too, or at least be aware of it. Also, Ian McBurney does a lot of accessibility stuff, and he has a jQuery plugin if you still use jQuery. it's also pretty easy to look at what he's doing and take it out of jQuery. But he has something that does this for you. He has a script, so you can check it out if you want something that's already built that handles it. So this is example of a dialogue written by Ian McBurney, actually. He has a whole library of these eBay mind patterns. You can see you hit the dialogue button, you hit tab, and you just go back and forth between the close button and the only tab stop in the dialogue. And if you look closely, you can see when I hit escape, it closed the dialogue. That's something that's pretty expected for stuff like dialogues and slide panes that obscure content. You have to be able to escape out of it. So this is actually one example where you want your keyboard usage to differ slightly from mouse usage, is skip links. You might have come across them. They're wonderful, but you'll never see them if you only use a mouse. You get to them if you keep hitting tab, and they're often at the top of a web page, and they allow you to skip past a whole bunch of content that may have a lot of tab stops, like navigation menu or header, where if you're going through a website or a web app and you're, you know, changing pages constantly, you don't want to have to tab through everything once again, because every time you click the link, you'll go back to the top. So this lets you skip to right where you want to go. And they're pretty nice. The way you do it, the thing that you want to be able to skip to, like the main menu or the main content div, you have to add an ID so you can link to it, and you need to put it in the tab order. By tab index is -1. Sorry, not the tab order. You want to make it focusable, not in the tab order. You add your link, just link to it, link to the ID. It's an internal one. Easy. And the magic is in the styles. And the style on the left is actually something you can use even outside of skip links. It's a way to hide something visually, but not from a screen reader. So as I mentioned, screen readers do pay attention to styling, and it's not just display and visibility. They pay attention to other things as well. And that can differ from screen reader to screen reader and screen reader browser combination to different screen reader browser combination. This is the like foolproof cross-screen reader, cross-browser way to hide something visually and still have it accessible. Sometimes, you know, if you create those little icon buttons where you only have an icon and you want to have like text in there, so if you're listening to it, you hear a menu button and not just three lines or whatever the icon text is, or unreadable glyph often, then you want to put in some actual text and hide it. That's the way to do that. Oh, yes, and you remove it on focus, so that means like when focus hits your skip link, then it appears. So common mistakes, I'm gonna go really quickly through things people often do, often without thinking or without considering it, that are anathema to screen readers and keyboards. So removing an element with focus from the DOM. If you remember that dialogue example I showed you, when I hit escape, focus went back to the button that I used to open the dialogue, or essentially back to where you were before you opened this thing. And what happens if you don't do that, if you have focus within an element, and then you delete that element, is focus will go back to its first parent that's in the focus order, and that's usually document.body. So essentially, you're navigating through a website, you open the dialogue or a modal or something, you're like, oh, this is cool, I'm listening to this, or I'm looking at this, you close it, and suddenly you're back at the top of the page. And that's pretty annoying. There are some browsers that handle this for you. but don't rely on it. It's only Chrome and Firefox and Safari, I think. They have something called sequential focus navigation start point. So that means they keep track of where you were, but don't rely on it because the other browsers don't do it and really should be handling it anyway. Okay, automatically changing focus in response to something other than a user event. So if you're getting into this and you're like, okay, I need to manage my focus, that's great. Just manage your focus with care because you always want, essentially, if you're using a keyboard, you have a single point of entry into the DOM, or into the page, rather. If you're using a mouse or if you're using your finger or something, you have this 2D canvas and you can interact with anything you can see. But if you're using a keyboard, you can interact with a single thing at a time and you move it. And it's really important to be able to have control over moving that point of interaction, because if it starts moving without your input, it's really confusing. You feel like you can't actually navigate the web page. You don't have control anymore. If you're listening to it, it's really weird because suddenly like words start happening and you don't know what's going on. So I've actually seen somebody with a slider who thought that it would be a good idea to start like moving focus to each new slide as it changed. And that's actually a really bad idea because things happen and you don't know why. So only do it in direct response to a user event, like a click, a tab, something. Ooh, that's exciting. Okay. Yes, angry cat number three. So making everything focusable, I touched on this. Screen readers are very good at reading text. And even if you're not using a screen reader, if you're just using the keyboard, you can still scroll. You can use arrow keys and scroll down. You don't need to make text focusable to make it accessible. It already is accessible. None of you guys would do that. Newbie mistake. Positive tab indices. I have never heard a good reason for these. Don't do them. Your options are 0 or -1. Focus order, or not in focus order, but focusable. Create good focus order with your DOM. Move things around with styling. Yeah, positive tab indices. Just start creating a mess, and you'll never dig yourself out of it. Oops. Oh, that's even more excitement. Okay, there we go. Yeah, this is actually, I think, one of the most common. With app frameworks and component frameworks, they often create non-native elements. This is also true for web components and custom elements. If it's not native, it doesn't have native functionality built in. So things like buttons, form inputs, selects, links, all of these have keyboard accessibility just built in, and it's wonderful because you can use it, you can add a click event, and it'll just work with the keyboard. If you aren't using those elements, it will not work. Some people think, like, people learn about ARIA stuff and roles and all these extra semantics, and those are wonderful. You should use them when appropriate, but they do not add interaction for you. They only add semantics. You can't add div role equals button and expect screen readers and keyboards to know to treat it like a button. They won't, they'll treat it like a div. You should still do it because the screen reader will read it as a button, but it won't handle the actual interaction for you. You still have to do that yourself. So first of all, just use buttons and, you know, style it. But if you're doing something more advanced, like a tab, and there's obviously no tab element, and you decide to create that with a div, you have to handle the keyboard directly yourself. So that means 13 is enter, 32 is space, or vice versa. I'm pretty sure 13 is enter. Also, you can use event.key. I think that's supported in most browsers now. But yeah, keyboard event.key. If you weren't following, they like deprecated which and key code and char code before like event.key was actually supported. But I think it is now, except for Android browser. So handle your clicks. Yeah, providing interaction only on hover. Self-explanatory, you also have touch things now that you probably want to do the touch things. So this should happen automatically. If you like make tooltips, for example, visible on focus, that'll automatically handle your touch devices for you. If you click on a button, that'll focus the button if your tooltip happens, shows on focus and not just on hover. You won't have to add click handlers or anything, so pretty nice. And also, obviously, for keywords. So yeah, that's it. Go forth and make your widgets accessible.